Good morning, everybody, and hi. All of you know my name by now. I have been in this journey with all of you for quite some time now. Most of the time, even when I landed here, and some of the people ask me, what is this Pardada Pardadiya all about? Because this sounds like you're working with some elderlies. So there is a philosophy behind the name. As you know, Pardada Pardadi means great-grandfather and great-grandmother. So what it means that we have two theories behind it. One is that we believe that anybody who's rooted enough can only develop. Because a tree which has strong roots lasts the longest. And secondly, we believe in the ancient system of education where Guruji or your teacher or mentor never trained you to get 95% marks, but always trained you to be a good human being. So that's why we kept this name, Pardada Pardadi. So firstly and then secondly, why girls? Unfortunately, we are in an area where whenever I go to anybody's house and ask them, how many children you have, mom? And she will say, 9. And there are 5 girls giggling behind her. And when you ask these girls, why are you giggling? She says, my mother only counted my brothers. So these are the faceless faces of the citizenship, which is never counted. So that's why we are saying to facilitate the creation of socially and economically empowered rural society. And our focus is only on women and girls. As you can see, girls and women through the tools that we have. Why Anup Sheher of all the places? Yesterday also I was saying, and I feel ashamed of that, whenever you pick up a newspaper and you read about Bulandshahr, it is always for a wrong reason. Historically, all invasions in India happened from northern side. So people are not used to working together. It's very patriarchal, it's very criminal. And as just told you, that women and girls are not even recognized. So that's why we thought, why not work in Anup Sheher? And Anup Sheher being in Uttar Pradesh. And even again, somebody was asking me yesterday, how does the state of Uttar Pradesh work? So I shared a joke with the person. I said, one day a US president came to India and met Mayawati and said, okay, let's go to your state. So they went, they saw that children were on the streets, the schools were closed. So he said, children look very happy. How does that work? So he said, Ram Bharose. Ram Bharose means mercy of God. But he said, Ram Bharose. And Ram Bharose is also an Indian name for a man. So then they went further, and there were women who were working in the fields. They had big log of wood on their head, and then they were still smiling. And then again, this president asked, how does that work? So he said, Ram Bharose. So the president went back and said, Mayawati ji, I don't want anything. I want your Ram Bharose. So this is one typical state of few of the others where it's total statelessness. To the extent when we go and ask some of the organizations to support us or to work with us, they said, no, we can't work in your state because the state government is not at all active in encouraging partnerships. So that's why we are in Uttar Pradesh. Okay, and another, just I don't want to take you through all this, but only 45% of the girls are enrolled in the schools. So I'm not even talking about retention rate, I'm just talking about enrollment rate, and that's also on the basis of government statistics. So you can very well imagine whether it is 45 or 4.5%. Okay, this is our model for development. We say that we started 13 years ago with education as a focus because we realized that the most vulnerable of the lot were girl children. And we started with a school because we didn't know what is an alternate word for the work that we wanted to do, because we wanted to make these girls economically and socially empowered. And we all know it's easier to make anybody economically empowered, but social empowerment in a place where girls get killed because she chose a boy of her own choice and not of the same caste. So bringing social empowerment in such a region is very difficult. But we are still trying, and we hope that we'll reach there someday. And rest, I'm not going into rest of the programs. The rest of my presentation will only focus on education. When we started with 45 girls and only 14 remained. And the reason was that the parents never believed that what we are saying is for true. They said that if my daughter comes to your school and she remains with you, and after 10 or 12 years of education, she still has to cut grass, why should I send her to your school? Because we are in an absolute agrarian area. There are no employment opportunities at all. And for all of us present here, education has to lead to something. So that question mark was always there. And the second thing she said was, how will I get my daughter married? And this package encouraged the mothers to send their daughters to school. And today we have 1,200 girls at the school over the journey of 12 years. Many a times we are questioned like, your model is expensive. Oh, you're spending 21,000 rupees per child, per girl. Why? And in the same money, such and such organization is reaching out to many more students, and your organization is only catering to 1,200 students. Then I always ask them, sit back and think, how much money do you spend on your own daughter's education? Why this disparity? Just because this child comes from a family whose average income is only 1,000 rupees or 1,200 rupees. When we are saying that the girls have to come to school, we have to take care of their puberty needs also. And if we don't do that, they will definitely drop out. So for Pardada Pardadi, when this girl enters into the school, she's my daughter. So when she's my daughter, I have to take care of her. So that's why we have the sanitary napkins program. And remember I said that in that earlier slide that we assure jobs. It's a very difficult task. How can you assure jobs to so many students who pass out every year? But we are still working on it. And this year, like, a batch of 28 girls have passed and 19 have opted for further studies. And rest of them are going to work with us. So I think we will crack the formula soon. When I can stand here and say that, yeah, batch of 100 girls passed out and they all are employed. I don't want to, like, you all can read a little bit of impact that we have had so far. This program, this toilets program, is again part of our education journey. The reason is that when we used to ask the girls, oh, you didn't come to school yesterday. What happened? Ma'am, I had a stomach upset. And I had to wait till the sunset, because of which the situation got aggravated and I fell sick. Second thing is that they said, was that you teach us all about gender. You tell us that you are equal to the girls. Boys, sorry. Why is it that when I need to ease myself, I have to wait till the evening or wait for the dark hours in the morning? How am I equal? So we said, we created an incentive program. And we said, okay, we will construct toilets in the homes of the girls who have been regularly coming to the school. Similarly, we have a program where we provide solar lights, lamps, because UP and electricity don't go hand in hand. So when we came to class 10th boards, the girls said, we can't study at night because there's no light and mother doesn't allow the kerosene wick. So we said, how do you solve the situation? We said, okay, any home where the children have 70% attendance on the monthly basis will be given a solar light. So these kind of incentivizations have helped us to have a greater impact on education and retention of students in the school. So how do you ensure that these girls go for further education and they don't get back into the cycle of getting married at the age of 14 years and becoming mothers at the age of 16 years and all their dreams get crushed? So these are the two thoughts I